If you've been following my channel, you probably know that I used to work in editorial at Penguin Random House, as well as at a top literary agency in New York City. So today I want to reveal the biggest shocking things that I learned when I was working in the publishing industry so that you can also learn more about it. Publishing is an industry that often feels like it operates behind closed doors and only special people get to get in and know what's going on. And I'm really, really passionate about opening up those doors and educating aspiring authors on how the traditional publishing industry works when it comes to the big five publishing houses, so that you can be more informed whenever you're deciding what to do with your manuscript draft. Publishing shouldn't feel like an exclusive club, and I am really, really passionate about making it feel more accessible to aspiring authors, because I want you to know that it is achievable for you to get your book published by a big five house, and knowing more about the industry is only going to help you do that. I certainly had no idea how books got published before I worked in the industry, so as I started getting my footing and learning how it worked, there were several things that were just really surprising to me that I would have never thought of, so that's what I'm going to cover today. Knowing all this helps you put yourself in a better position if your ultimate goal is to get traditionally published. Now, if you are interested in book publishing, I recommend subscribing to my channel. I post a new video every week, either with information about the publishing industry and how to get a literary agent, or tips for writing a book, especially if you are working on a novel, so I would love to have you around. So the first shocking thing that struck me about the publishing industry is the sheer number of books. There are books everywhere in the office of any literary agency or any publishing house. When I think back to my cubicle at Penguin Random House, what I remember seeing is just it being completely filled with boxes of books at any given moment. Publishing is synonymous with book mail. You have literary agents sending out their authors' new books to editors and media. You have editors sending out their authors' new books to literary agents and media. There is just constantly books coming in and out, and if you are in a lower level position in the editorial department, a big part of your job is going to be dealing with all that book mail. Something that surprised me when I got into the industry is that there are actually a lot of different copies of one specific book. So before the book actually goes on sale, the publishing house will create what we call galleys or ARCs, which are advanced reader's copies. They are a lower quality book, but they're still bound and they still have the cover. In some cases, actually, they don't even have the cover yet and it just has text on the front of it. For any book that gets published, there's going to be at least one iteration of a galley or ARC. Sometimes there's two or three iterations of the galley or ARC. And then you have the hardcover copy, and then you have the paperback copy, which are released on different dates. Usually paperback comes out 1 year after the hardcover. So there are just tons of editions of a single book floating around the office. And there are so many extra books in a publishing house that actually on my floor of my office, there was a huge, basically dumpster bin where people would put in their old galleys or ARCs, especially when the hardcover came out and they no longer wanted the galley of that book. And it was just full of books at any given moment. And it was kind of fun because if you had downtime, you could go in there and pick out books that maybe you had wanted to read but didn't have a copy of. So it's a book lover's dream, but it was something that did really surprise me. And just the sheer number of books that I amassed personally over the period of time working in the industry was quite incredible. The next thing that shocked me about the publishing industry is that the people that you see, especially as an aspiring author, as a gatekeeper, actually often gets rejected too. We often think of literary agents and editors at publishing houses as having all of this power, that if they love a book, it is going to get published and you just have to impress them and then you will see your book in Barnes & Noble. But actually, the literary agents and editors often get really, really heartbroken whenever a book that they love doesn't end up getting published. The hard truth is that even if you get a literary agent and they love your book, that doesn't necessarily mean that it is the golden ticket to getting published. That's because the literary agent still has to convince an editor at a publishing house that the book is worth taking on and that the book is worth whatever investment that they want the publishing house to put into it. And this is the part that I really didn't understand for a while. Even if the editor at the publishing house loves the book and wants to make a book deal offer, it doesn't necessarily mean that they can. The editors at the publishing houses actually have to get sign off from a number of people higher up than them in order to make that book deal offer. Remember, publishing houses, especially when we're talking about the big five, They're large corporations, so everything really has to run on a tight ship when it comes to finances. So say an editor falls in love with a book that an agent offers them, they then have to go to usually someone in the marketing team high up, as well as the editor-in-chief and or the publisher of the imprint that they work at. All of those people have to agree with them that this book is worth something, and they will help the editor determine what offer they can make before they can make it. And all too often, there are cases where an editor loves, loves, loves the book, but someone along the chain of command says, you know, it's not really for us, and it gets shut down. In our weekly editorial meetings, where the editors would present the projects that they're interested in or the projects that they got in from agents that week, I often saw editors present things that they thought were really interesting, and then other members of the team would say, oh, I'm not sure, or, you know, it's just like this other thing that got published, and they kind of shut them down. I hope it maybe makes you feel a little bit better if you are getting rejected from literary agents currently, knowing that literary agents also get rejected and editors at publishing houses also get rejected quite a bit. It's a side of the industry that we don't really think about whenever we're not on the side of it. The next thing that really surprised me about the publishing industry is all of the hype and concern around bestseller lists. So a Big Five publishing house puts a lot of effort and energy into ensuring that as many of their books as possible make it to as many bestseller lists as possible on a weekly basis. The main lists that come out are the New York Times. That is the most highly regarded bestseller list in the US, as well as Publishers Weekly bestseller and USA Today bestseller. And in the UK, you have, I know, the Sunday Times bestseller, as well as a few others. So every single week, agents and editors will check the lists as soon as they came out and see if any of their books have made it on. And if they had, they will immediately adjust the description copy that goes online describing the book on Amazon or Barnes & Noble to say New York Times bestseller. And they will actually adjust the cover to add a little stamp that says bestseller or add text that says bestseller. They are immediately going to capitalize on that bestseller status as soon as the book makes it. Something else that's interesting is how a book actually becomes a bestseller on one of those lists. Each of the lists has a slightly different algorithm or a slightly different database that they use to track the book's sales and then put it in the list format. So that's why all of the lists are slightly different. Even though you will likely see some overlap between them, they're not identical because they use different databases to track the book sales. But an interesting thing is that it is possible for a book to become what we call an instant bestseller. And that is when the exact same week that it goes on sale, it becomes a bestseller. So how does that happen? Often the publishing house will put a lot of marketing effort into trying to get as many pre-orders as possible for a specific title in order to push it to that instant bestseller position. That doesn't necessarily mean that every bestseller you see on the list had a lot of marketing effort behind it, but that is something that the marketing department will keep in mind at a publishing house. They'll say, we really want to push this book to bestseller status, so let's do X, Y, and Z to get as many sales as possible. The next shocking thing about the industry is that a single book can have many, many different covers. This is one of the most fun parts of working in the industry. I absolutely loved going to cover meetings and seeing the designers at the publishing house present all of their concepts for the book's cover. And many authors get really, really excited about seeing their book's face for the very first time. What will usually happen is the designer will present maybe a dozen or so different cover options in some kind of meeting. And then the marketing team, the editor-in-chief or publisher, and the editor who acquired that book will go into the meeting, review the cover designs, and pick out maybe 3 to 6 that they'd like to move forward with. And then they will present that subset of cover designs to the literary agent and the author to get their input. Once you have a basic design you want to work with, they will play around with the font, the colors, things like that to make sure it is perfect and will be appealing to the target audience. So that means that for every book that you see published, there are dozens of covers out there somewhere that actually didn't make it, which is kind of interesting to know. And sometimes if the original cover that the book gets published with just no longer feels right, or maybe the book didn't sell as well as the publisher expected with that cover, they will actually pull out one of the different cover concepts that the designer originally came up with to publish the book with a new cover in the paperback format. So that's why sometimes you'll see a hardcover has a different cover than the paperback. Also, if a book gets sold to an international market, the international publishing house is gonna come up with its own cover. So For a single book, you could have anywhere between 2 to 12 different covers for it, which is kind of cool. The last shocking thing that I learned while working in the publishing industry is that film rights often sell instantaneously. So even though we typically don't see books become movies until years or even decades after they've been published, more and more frequently these days, the film rights actually get sold simultaneously with, or even earlier than, the book rights get sold. What that means is that there are film scouts in the industry who read early drafts of the manuscripts that literary agents are sending out to publishing houses and see which ones have film potential, and they can potentially make a film deal with the literary agent before the literary agent has even found the publisher. So why does it take film studios so long to produce a film of the book if the rights have already been sold whenever the book gets published? Well, the film studio will usually buy those rights and then sit on them for quite a while. Of course, a lot goes into making a film. So maybe they need to work on the casting. They need to figure out who all is going to be involved in the production. So sometimes they will snatch up the rights and then just kind of hold them for a while. And sometimes there are cases where those rights actually expire before any film gets made. For many, many of the books that you see on the bestseller lists, they actually do have film rights sold in many cases. You just don't know it yet. So it's always cool to see whenever a bestseller actually becomes a film. I hope this gave you some inside knowledge into how the publishing industry works, and I hope some of these facts were interesting to you. Let me know in the comments what else you'd like to know about the publishing industry, if you'd like me to go more in depth on any of the points I just covered, or if you'd like me to talk more about getting published by a big five publishing house. If you're looking for some more insider information about the industry, check out my video on secrets about the publishing industry. I also have some interesting tidbits in there. And as always, if you found this video interesting or helpful, please hit that like button and subscribe to my channel. It means a lot to me, and I would love to have you in the community. Thanks so much for watching, and happy writing.